Hello, my name is David Faure and I work for KDAB. In this video, I would like to show you how to write a widget style in order to style your widgets. So you have this application where you can see QDesigner. That's the basic design of the application in the first place of the window. And then we want to style this. If we just change the palette, as we said in the previous video, it will look like this. What we want to do is to write a widget style so that it looks much better. There are a number of things here, like the hover effect on the button leads to a gradient. I'm not sure if that's going to be very visible in the video. So instead of buttons, let's have a look at progress bars, because in here the gradient is actually much, much more visible. So the question we are asking ourselves is, how do I change the way that Q progress bar paints itself? Well, let's have a look at the code. If we go to Q progress bar, then we can see that the paint event for QProgressBar doesn't do much. All it does is to call into, in here it's a style painter, it will end up simply calling into the style itself, and we can change the way that this works. So it's simply calling the style with CEProgressBar. Okay, we make a note of that. QStyle painter is not really interesting, it's just a very basic wrapper for QStyle. So what matters to us is to go to QStyle. So if we have a look at the, let's do this full screen. If we have a look at the QStyle documentation, we can see that it's actually a whole set of pure virtual methods, right? It's just API. We were looking at draw control, was it? And then that's draw control here. This ends up in QStyle draw control. And at the very base class, it's a pure virtual. So we would have to implement everything, every single bit of every widget. That would be a lot of work. So what we usually do is to have a look at the derived class QCommonStyle, which has a bunch of shared implementation between various styles. It doesn't have everything, but it's still a much better base to start from. Okay, so what is implemented in QCommonStyle draw control? Well, the documentation doesn't tell us anything. Okay, what do we do in such a case? Well, we're going to have a look at the code. Okay, qcommonstyle.cpp. And if we search for CE progress bar, we can see how it's usually implemented to paint a progress bar. Well, it's delegating to three more calls to draw control. One for the groove, that's the overall area, kind of the underlying rectangle or run rectangle in our case. So the groove, the contents, which show the actual progress value, and the label, which is the text on the right. Okay, so that implementation looks good to us. We don't have to change that one. What we are going to do instead is to change the painting for the groove, the label, and the contents. So that's what we are going to do in our own style. So let's write a test style class, which will derive from QCommonStyle in order to reuse that basic implementation. Actually, if you do that, you might lose the painting for a number of widgets which are not part of QCommonStyle. So usually what you would like to do is to first inherit from QProxyStyle, as I mentioned here, because that one basically delegates to the native style of your platform for everything, right? It's a proxy, so if you don't do anything, it will delegate everything, meaning you will get menus and tab bars and everything, and you can start re-implementing your own widgets. But at some point, you want to make sure that your rendering is completely under your control. It doesn't depend on the platform. So then you change the base class to QCommonStyle, and this way, that's for the cases where you want to have the same rendering everywhere. So I usually do this with indirection. I use the super define here to simply say, let me change the base class between QCommonStyle and QProxyStyle to play with both of them. In this example here, because it's only buttons, checkboxes, and progress bars, we can implement all of that, so we can actually use QCommonStyle as the base class. All right, let's go to the draw control. So buttons, we won't talk about that. We are only interested in progress bar. What we do for CE progress bar is to call up to QCommonStyle, and we do this explicitly so that even if we derive from QProxyStyle, we have this under control. We want the default implementation, the one we were just looking at. And all it will do is to call into these three things. Good. So what do we do now for the groove, the contents, and the label? Well, we could implement them here, but in the end of your project, that file, the teststyle.cpp, would end up being 10,000 lines long. I've done projects like that, and it becomes hard to maintain. So over time, what I've developed is a way to keep the code modular and maintainable. So what I do is to create a small helper class for every type of widget. So we have one for progress bars. I call it progress bar style helper. You can call it whatever you want. Doesn't derive from anything. It's really just to separate the code for styling progress bars. And in here, we can have methods that we call whatever we want. In this case, let's draw the groove, draw the contents, and draw the text. Okay, what are we going to do to draw the groove? We want a round rectangle, if you remember from the drawing. It's that rectangle, right? And one problem is, what color do we use? Well, the designer tells us it should be that color. Usually for widgets, you can use QPalette, but QPalette is quite limited. It doesn't have specific colors for every type of widget. In the palette, you can say what's the background color for a button, but you can't say what's the color for the outline of a progress bar. It doesn't have that kind of details. So what I recommend doing instead is your own class. I call it color repository, and it has as many different colors as I need, but instead of hard coding them into the style itself, it's much better to have them separated. So what we are doing here is button outline color. So you can see one benefit here is it's the same outline colors as for the buttons. So we can share that method and call it from both helper classes. In there, we have this logic where the color depends on dark or light mode. So when I change here, dark or light, it will actually change the colors for the rendering. Very nice. So we simply set up the painter with pen and background color for the brush and draw the rounded rectangle, and that's it. We have drawn the groove for the progress bar. Now we'll do the same for the contents. They look a little bit fancy here with this gradient, and that's simply done by the brush that we use here being actually defined with a gradient. And of course, the designer gave me the values to use here for the defining of the gradient. So that's for the drawing. The other thing you might notice is that by default, the groove would stop here and the text would be outside the groove. That's the way the default implementation is in QCommon style, or actually in this case, I'm using the Windows style, the basic old Windows style, most of the implementation of it being in QCommon style. We don't want that. We want the text inside of the groove. So basically, we want to define the area for the groove to be the whole widget. And that's something we can do in another pure virtual from QStyle. And that would be the sub-element rect. If I go here, sub-element rect is going to be called whenever the widget wants to know what part of the widget contains the groove, what's the rectangle for the contents, what's the rectangle for the label. And we can implement that in our own method here. Usually it's a switch on the type of sub-element, but actually in our special case here, we want the area for the groove to be the whole widget, so we simply return option rect. We want the area for the contents to be the whole widget as well. We will, of course, calculate where to show it, but the overall area is the whole widget. And we simply want the label to be an area that stops six pixels before the right edge, otherwise they would collide one into the other here. So we simply define that area to be everything except the last 6 pixels, and then we'll draw it right aligned, as we do here, align right, and it's at the right place. So by re-implementing the sub-element rect method, we can also define where things are. This way you could, for instance, take a spin box and have the minus and plus buttons be on the side instead of next to each other and these kind of things, right? You can change where things are, and that is not just painting, it will have an effect on mouse handling as well. So there we are. We've implemented a few, the style for a few widgets. There will be a link to the code in the description for that video where you can see how this is done in more details. And hopefully I will get time to implement more of that widget style for KDE. We'll see if the future allows me to do that. If you have any questions about the code for this widget style, please go ahead and ask in the comments. In the next video, I will show you how to try and do the same styling with Qt style sheets and whether that's easier or whether we hit some limitations. You'll see in the next video. Bye-bye.